You were not one of the signatories to the pause petition last week, but you operate a generative AI search engine. Are you one of those that thinks a pause is helpful or just adds to the noise?
I don't think a pause is feasible. It's hard to tell people, like, don't think about this. Don't work on this abstract general purpose technology. I do think it is important for lawmakers to think about how to deal with a changing job landscape. I do think it'll make sense for us to regulate this technology as it gets applied in specific areas, such as military, healthcare, transportation, and so on. Regulation makes sense there, but it's kind of like trying to regulate the chipsets and say, this chip is not allowed to make this kind of computation or compute dysfunction. It's just very hard to do that versus when you apply chips and put them into a weapon, there is actual regulation of how that weapon should be used. And I'm not using weapons because I think this is weapons-grade technology. I think I'm just using that in that it's a general purpose technology. It's more like a hammer or the internet. And on the internet, you can share illegal and horrific content, but we don't make the entire internet illegal and say, hey, how about we slow down internet pipe? Instead, we say, no, if you share this particular kind of content, like child pornography or like murder videos and things like that, like we make that illegal, and that makes a lot of sense.
Richard, we were just looking at that exact tweet, basically, that you put out there saying regulate it in a thoughtful manner here. It's interesting, you seem to be aligning in some ways with what I think of what's been being put out by other professors. I'm thinking particularly of Emily Bender, the Stochastic Parrots report, where she's saying sometimes when you're putting too much thought around the intelligence of artificial intelligence, you're almost adding to the hype here.
That's exactly right. I feel like there's a whole industry now of what I call them anti-hype hypers. And by them saying, oh, wow, this is so omnipotent, so dangerous, we have to regulate it. Honestly, it probably makes some people think, wow, well, then I really got to have it. Like countries, certain organizations where values aren't really important to them. At the same time, I think we're anthropomorphizing a lot this technology, thinking it has its own thoughts and things like that. It is incredibly powerful. The impact on jobs is real, but it doesn't have a super intelligence that will have a mind of its own. It really just predicts the next word because that's what you're asking it to do. It has no capability currently to say, oh, I just don't want to predict next words anymore. I want to just have my own thoughts and do my own thing.
It's interesting, of course. There's also this narrative, Ed, that some that were signing the petition for a pause perhaps were just a bit behind the curve in the application of their own AI technology. But Ed, you've been playing with you.com in particular.
Yeah, you know, I use ChatGPT, I use Bard by Google, Richard. I have been using you.com, very similar products. And the question I put to you, because you actually seem to be taking a somewhat objective view on this, is whether this is just sour grapes from an industry trying to catch up with a clear leader in open AI.
I do think so. I do think some folks trying to slow it down probably say, oh, it'll be nice if we have some time to catch up to this whole situation. We were actually at you.com the first to, instead of trying to regulate the technology or say this is impossible to use for a search engine, we just try to make it better. For instance, they hallucinated a lot. And so now we added the capability of these LLMs to have citations and to stick closer to the sources that they find online. We launched that in December last year, and OpenAI and others like Bing have copied that capability now. And I think it makes the whole large language model space better and more useful for a search engine.
Yes. Caroline, JP Morgan out with that note this morning, right? Calling Microsoft a clear early leader in the generative AI space, its partnership with OpenAI. Big names moved early here, didn't they?
Yeah, and Richard, you could speak to this. You've worked at big names. You worked at Salesforce. You now got your own startup. Is it right? Is OpenAI sucking all the oxygen out of the room when it shouldn't be? How much do we need to work to think of smaller players? And are the bigger players really marching ahead here?
Yeah, it's a great question. You know, Microsoft has its monopoly days and used that monopoly power a lot in the past. And they're certainly applying that playbook now to, you know, an almost subsidiary of Microsoft. You know, they own 50% of OpenAI. And it is, it can be tough. You know, we launched certain capabilities like LLMs with citations, then Microsoft later on copied that feature. They're now trying to end all the little competition and search engines that they used to want to support in their struggle against Google. Now they say, oh, it seems like we would be able to do this ourselves. So they increase the prices by 10 or even 50x, making it not feasible anymore to partner with them. So there's definitely that attempt from Microsoft to try to get back to this monopoly power.
Interesting. And of course, I'm sure Microsoft will go to for comment as to whether they feel that they're acting in an anti-competitive manner. But Richard, what do you do at U.com to continue to be relevant in the space, to continue to grow?
Yeah, we've been very much ahead of everyone when we launched this large language model chat search engine in December last year. The field moved so quickly, it didn't last very long. When we became the first to have multimodal outputs in these chat models. So if you ask the chat model, oh, what's the stock price of Salesforce? Instead of making up a bunch of numbers, which what most of these models would do, we just show you a stock ticker. So the outputs can have different modalities, can be a table, can be a graph, can be an image, can be an interactive element. So we essentially introduced the idea of an app store to a search engine. And that allows the chat model to be a lot more powerful and an actual replacement to Google. So we're trying to merge the best ideas of a traditional search engine with the ChatGPT-like capabilities of summarize this whole website for me, write me an entire HTML website or longer piece of code and all of these things. And we'll continue to innovate, and some more exciting things are in the pipeline.
Well, continue to innovate. Richard, the Bloomberg Opinion Editorial Board have an opinion piece out today saying that an AI pause would be a disaster for innovation. You seem to agree with that argument. My question is, what are you doing to innovate? How busy are you going out there trying to get new checks from your backers to continue the research, to continue the development?
Yeah, I do think it's just impossible to regulate. It's like saying, hey, these models need the internet, so let's make the internet a little bit slower. Or these models need chipsets. How about we make chips a little bit slower so that we slow this all down? Because some of these chips could be used to do bad things. It's just not even feasible. Not every country would participate. And it's just, it doesn't even make sense because the technology can be used for so many good things. We've trained the same technology that you see for textual chat in natural language English. We used that technology back in my Salesforce days to train on protein generation. So we can find new cures for cancer. We can find new cures for viruses and things like that. This technology is so general purpose. It can do a lot of amazing things. And to say, let's slow it down at the very basic layer just doesn't make sense. When you apply it to medicine and other areas, then of course, you know, FDA needs to do this.
Richard, does U.com survive in a world where Google's Bard and Microsoft through Bing are offering exactly the same thing? Does the plucky player survive?
We think so. There have been multiple smaller search engines that are worth billions of dollars already, like DuckDuckGo, and people still care about privacy. And to be honest, Google's Bard and Microsoft Bing have not yet caught up with everything that we do. And I think we have a shot.